Hey, welcome back to the Bernie Blackout News. I'm joined with some wonderful guests.
Ooh, where are they?
Guests. Our friend Bob is back.
Bob! Hello, I'm Bob.
Hi, Bob. Good to see you. And Ivana, nice to have you.
Thank you.
We're just going to have a little election conversation and discuss, you know, the nature of things. So, Bob, have you been following the election?
Yeah, I follow it everywhere I go. Can't get away from it, you know.
I hear you. You know, it's everywhere. Every time I turn on the TV, there's Donald Trump yelling at us. And
yeah, he's a real winner.
He's won at a lot of things. His hair is great.
You know, people say that his hair is that it like stands up a lot. My hair also stands up a lot. I was thinking of going orange. Do you think I would look good
you
in orange?
You have great hair too.
Yeah.
I don't want to make fun of him. His hair is great. Your hair is great.
Yeah, we can all just have great hair days together for days and days.
Let's make America great again. Make America have a great hair day again.
Okay, yeah, good one.
Yeah, it's good.
Okay, what else? What else are we going to talk about?
I don't know. It's usually sort of a stream of consciousness, but we got some ideas. Did you hear about huge win in Wisconsin last night?
Who won?
Bernie Sanders.
Oh.
10 points. Boom, put it on the pile of caucuses he won. Do you know what a caucus is?
I think so. It's like for sealing up windows and doors.
Yeah.
Okay, tell me about a caucus.
A caucus is when everyone votes at the same time.
That's what it is?
And you go into a room and they're like, hey, if you're on this side, if you're a Hillary person, go to that side. If you're a Bernie person, go to this side. And here's what it tells us.
What about if you're a puppet? What side do you go?
Puppets aren't allowed to vote, man.
Puppets of this side. Puppets of this side. Puppets
you think
this
we live
side.
In a democracy puppets where puppets can vote? No, man. It's like much more uptight than that. You're lucky if you can vote if you're a person. Did you know how much voter suppression is going on this season? It's terrible.
Yeah. That's why I always keep my identification right in this pouch right here.
Oh, yeah. Let's see. This is a beautiful pouch, Bob. There was a point I wanted to make about the caucus, which is that it reflects why Bernie is stronger in the November, because everyone gets to vote in a caucus.
Everyone? What if they don't go to the caucus?
Well, then you're a loser who doesn't want to participate in our democracy.
I don't think it makes sense what you're saying. Everyone votes in a caucus, but the primary, everyone votes. The caucus, only the people that, you know how to go to a caucus. I mean, really, I don't think people know what that even is.
Well, and it's getting into the complicated parts about election stuff. But the basic plot is, when Bernie wins a caucus, it means we're going to do better in November because everyone can vote in a caucus. Whereas if it's a closed primary, like New York, you can only vote if you're a Democrat for the Democratic nominee.
What if they just did it on Facebook with likes or Instagram?
We would probably have a much higher voting thing.
Yeah, it'd be good.
I think there's talk about trying to do that, open source government, and voting online and internet runoff voting.
You can now vote online for this election. Go to the link at
bit.ly at diebold/ maybe we'll count it.
All right. Hey, quiet one over there. What you got to say about things? Or did you vote in the primary or the caucus?
No.
Why not? Where are you from?
New York.
Oh, that didn't happen yet. It's soon. It's 2 weeks away.
You can vote. Are you registered to vote?
I don't know. I registered in Vermont. Like a year ago.
To New York.
Okay.
And
I think you have to, I mean, this is part of the voter suppression is what she's experiencing, which is that you should have same day registration to be able to go and vote.
But
I
think you've
already missed the chance to register to vote in New York.
Oh, okay.
But we'll check in on that.
And puppets can't vote anywhere. It's messed up.
Yeah, and you're a felon too, so you probably can't vote either. Doubly. I don't mean to tell everybody about that great heist back in, anyway.
Well, the thing is
everybody's got their secrets. I didn't tell you to put your money in the Panama papers.
I just thought I was buying a newspaper in Panama. I thought it was about the canal. I thought it was like a Panama Canal Times.
I know you did, Bob, and that's why we're forgiving. We know that if you have $1 billion and you want to keep your taxes,
Well, it
wasn't, you don't want to be a loser who pays taxes.
It was only play money. It was like toys. You know whose face was on the money?
Who?
My grandfather. And he looks like me.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. That reminds me. You look a little like Bernie Sanders.
Yeah. He's related to me.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Is it, you know...
We're first... second, third cousins.
I get it.
Two-thirds cousins. Yeah. They call me Bob Sanders. We go to the same barbershop.
I feel ya. Yeah, definitely the same barbershop. Although he's gotten... Someone gave him a comb.
Right,
early.
You know what happened? We used to go to the same barbershop, and then he started going to a different barbershop where they put they put glue in his
this
hair.
This is what
to make
he was like before he cared and had to care. My friend Claire Bowden was so awesome. She said, she just loved Bernie's natural look. He was the mayor of Burlington. He just started lived his life and had hair and just like normal people. If you think too much about your hair, you're over concerned.
I hardly ever think about my hair.
I try not.
I think about my hair all the time.
Accidentally. I'm going to be on TV.
Ivana, how often do you think about your hair, would you say?
Every day.
Just once a day?
No, probably three times a day or so.
Three times a day?
You wash your hair three times a day?
No.
No.
I have to think about when I should wash my hair next, though. I think about it.
Let's reflect on that. Okay, viewers out there in TV land, when should Ivana wash her hair next? Should it be Friday? Should it be Saturday or Sunday? Vote on your smartphone right now. Text Ivana wash your hair to hashtag hairwash.com/washyourhair/Ivana.
/ be the media, / stay focused.
Focus, like a laser beam. Okay.
That's what we're talking about here. This isn't just random chatter of the delinquent liberal classes in Vermont. It is a focused conversation about...
Can I touch your beard again? I really like it.
Do you guys know about white supremacy and Ta-Nehisi Coates? We're going to dismantle this, Bob.
Let's take it apart.
I want you
take the cover off, and then we're going
to
take the spine apart.
Swear to me that you
pull
will
out those little strings that hold the pages together. Let's dismantle
very carefully.
It. Dismantle it.
Dismantle it. Good. This is a good book, right?
This book is written in bad taste.
No, it's good.
It tastes terrible.
You love it. I love it. Ta-Nehisi
Coates.
Yeah, it's okay. Ta-Nehisi Coates. I don't even have a coat. I have a coat of fur. I don't need a coat.
North Shire thing is on the cover, but...
North Shire. I love that store.
The greatest store.
I steal books from there all the time. I mean, I buy books from there all the time.
Well, we're going to take a quick break. And when
felon.
We come back from our break, we're going to talk a little bit
what
more about...
What do you want me to
about.
Break? I'll break it. I'll break anything. I'll break your finger. I'll break
you
your
see
bones.
See how it is here. Okay.
Break your ears.
Thank you, guys.
So how about Anderson Cooper? Who likes Anderson Cooper? I do. Anderson Cooper! Anderson Cooper! Anderson Cooper.
Anderson Cooper, why won't you cover Bernie Sanders?
What's up, Anderson Cooper? What's up? Why are you so pale? Go out in the sun.
You're one to talk.
I go out in the sun all the time. Pale. I'm just covered in fur. When I always wear a big hat. Okay.
Did you hear about the protest at CNN this week?
No.
There
no.
was a protest in
they tried
LA
to get Anderson to go outside?
Protesting the Bernie Blackout. And
Bernie Blackout.
This show is called the Bernie Blackout News because we say the mainstream media is just not covering the subject. And that makes it harder for democracy to happen. Meanwhile, Trump is getting tons and tons of airtime and
what's
Bernie
up with that?
Is barely...
What's up with that?
Well, he's a coverable guy. He's like a train wreck, a car crash. It's fun. They're easy to watch.
I'll think about that.
But the mainstream media has been lately having mea culpas, like William
mea
Crystal
culpa.
And New York Times
William
the other day was like,
Crystal.
Oh, you know, maybe the media did feed Trump and the media should think and do its job. And Dan Rathers was really smart the other day saying people have to be more courageous about standing up to racism and homophobia and all the baloney that's coming out of these candidates' mouths. So that's sort of what we're trying to do here, how to be brave in real time with puppets.
Yeah, I'm a really brave puppet, but I'm wondering about this. Do you think that the media just like Hillary more? Do you think that she gave them money, or they gave her money, or why don't they want to talk about Bernie? Well, they don't really talk about Hillary too much either. Think about that.
Maybe. I think both. It seems like they.
They don't talk about really. It's a hard puppets at all.
They never talk about puppets, and they never. You know, it's a tale too beautiful to tell. It's like,
but they're all puppets.
What if America got its act together and restored the rule of law? That's exciting.
Hmm.
Take money out of politics. Did you know there's the Bernie-crats now, where you can go and you can, there's like a whole, check out Bernie-crats, where there's like hundreds of people who are running on Bernie Sanders-like platforms out there. My friend Margaret Flowers is running in Maryland, so if you're a Maryland voter, go vote for Margaret Flowers.
Go Margaret Flowers. Awesome. Well, what happens if Hillary gets the nomination to all the momentum of the Bernie crowd, the Bernie Kratz, Bernie Kravitz,
that's
Lenny
Kravitz.
That's
a big question. I think a lot of us are going to be like,
Can't they just get along and do it together? Can't they be co-presidents?
I don't think so.
I mean, I would be co-president with Ivana if she would like to be my running mate. We could do it or with you. I mean, you're smart and you know everything, but you're difficult to get along with. Ivana is more like easygoing, mellow,
I feel
peaceful. Muy tranquilo. Yeah.
Tranquilo.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's, I think, Spanish.
I don't know. It's puppet. So why can't they be cocos? Like chocolate.
I'm not sure they're the same. It's sort of like night and day or going to a strip
club. I know, but together they could
be
so strong. It could be great. Could make America greater than great.
How do you feel about politics portrayed on Saturday Night Live?
Awesome!
You like it?
Because, I liked it when Hillary turned into Bernie. Did you see that one?
That one was
so
really clever.
Funny!
Yeah, Saturday Night Live has been pretty hot lately. A bunch of good things, like the Hillary impersonation, where calling Hillary's like sort of ahistorical morphing into bringing that to bear has been great. I mean, I call Hillary like an ahistorical pickpocket. She's always like, yeah, me and Nancy Reagan, we were working on AIDS and raising consciousness about that. You're like, did you just claim that you were this big part
did
of
Did you claim that you were Nancy Reagan? Just say no.
Just say no to claiming you're Nancy Reagan.
No, I'm not Nancy Reagan. No, no, no.
We're just pocketing the progress that other people made when really you just stood on the sidelines and voted for the Defense of Marriage Act. I mean, you know, it's just like annoying.
Yeah, but that was then. This is now. Then? Now.
Then? Now. Or like 5 years ago when Bernie was like, you know, this Panama-American free trade agreement, this is not going to go well. If you go to the Bernie Sanders for President subreddit, there's a very beautiful website where you can monitor some of the things going on, where you can check out Bernie Sanders news. If you haven't voted already, I encourage you to do so. Have faith. The world is not over yet, and we're going to try and win. Save the planet from climate change, and protect the water from frackers. And anyway, this has been the first maiden edition of the Bernie Blackout News. Thank you guys for coming. Bob, you're terrific. Great guest. Thank you so much.
Rub my neck again. That feels really good.
Yeah, a little massage. All right, peace, everybody. We'll see you next time.
Bye. I think we're not. Do we have to be done? Is this outro?
This is it. We're over. Why? Unless you want to say anything else.
I just want to keep talking and singing and dancing.
Well, that's why we got more shows later.
But what about talking about. Carly Fiona! Ben Carson, what about those guys?
Oh, yeah, we forgot to talk
about them. What about the Rubio?
What about him?
Well, I mean, what about him? Like, what about the Republican convention? What
you
about
would
a contested
make a,
convention?
You're a good pundit, man. I can see CNN hiring you.
Yeah. They hired me, but Rubio, I wouldn't work with that Anderson Cooper. He's too pale. makes me look like a puppet.
You could get used
All
to
right.
it.
That's a good cut point. And we're out.
Was that 15 minutes?
Hi, welcome to the Bernie Blackout News, our maiden edition of an attempt to tell the news about Bernie Sanders. because corporate media and has not really been doing its job this season politically. And so we see that as an opportunity as well as a fun place to make some media that goes straight to YouTube and also here on GNI TV in Manchester, Vermont. Let's catch up on the news. Pretty good news for Bernie Sanders this week. Wisconsin, the cheeseheads did it up good. Early exit polls from CNN was 55-44, and we think it was even higher than that later on. That's great. I don't have the exact numbers, but you know, another win, put it on the pile. Bernie's won like six in a row now, so awesome. It seems that every time there's a caucus, which is an open process, which is more like how the general election will be in the fall, Bernie does well, which is a good indicator of what is really at stake here. In the closed primaries, like New York, where you must vote for your party, it's a little bit arcane, but it shows that Hillary's weak in the general election because we win when Bernie Sanders people win when a lot of big turnout and people come in and everyone can vote. And so a lot of what we've been seeing this season is voter suppression and trying to keep people from voting, but we want everyone to vote. So that's why we're making it a little bit of media to say, hey, California, you are coming up. If you haven't voted yet for Bernie Sanders and still want to, that's a good idea, and you should, because we're on the way to winning the election here, and don't be denied if you have been listening to corporate media that tells you otherwise. Rosario Dawson was on Democracy Now! Last week. So articulate. She hit on a point I'd like to make, that in some ways the corporate media has been reluctant to tell the Bernie Sanders story because it's in some ways a tale too beautiful to tell. It doesn't fit the narrative, and there's no way to talk about it without being sort of excited about it, which is that maybe we will turn the corner with our government and take it back from the money people. That's exciting. That's a lot of people are interested in doing that, and Trump people often are some of the same. So different reasons for wanting to see the government do its job and work right, and the borders to work right. Mr. Trump said the other day, either we have a country or we don't, which is, it's like Mr. Trump's like a broken clock. He's right twice a day. He was right there. You know, if, for example, we have laws around protecting the water. And yesterday in Albany, there was a giant protest around fracking, asking Governor Cuomo to deny a permit that would allow the Constitution Pipeline to go through New York. The Department of Environmental Quality has to sign off on it. And that gives him the permission to say no to a process that will so the climate change is been a motivating factor for a lot of people. Bernie's put out this pretty amazing, I have one of the glossy bits of news, Bernie Sanders' plan for climate change. As you can see, banning fracking, wonderful. Like you're going to hear about that on MSNBC. New York Times, when the historic Paris Agreement was signed, the New York Times missed an opportunity to talk about Bernie's plan. It had been released that week, but for some reason just wasn't covered. So my name is Theo Talcott. I'm a environmentalist and yogi and other things. I've been making a climate show at GNET TV for about 5 years or something like that. But recently we've drifted into wanting to talk about Bernie Sanders. So I got a video I'm going to show you that I made when I was in Iowa, of all places. Check it out.
We want Bernie. your name and you're a volunteer?
Yeah, I'm Hannah Bishi, and I volunteer here.
Okay. Tell me, what does the political revolution mean to you?
It just means a change in the government, and I think it means youth becoming involved with politics a lot. I think part of the reason why a lot of young people they don't really care about politics is because it seems so foreign. It doesn't seem like our votes matter, really, but Bernie kind of offers the chance for them to matter again, for actual real change, for the type of policies and views that we want, like gay rights and free healthcare and free education, stuff like that, that the youth really care about, that isn't really being implemented in politics right now.
That's right.
Yeah.
And how's the volunteering been going for you? What have you been working on?
It's been really fun. It's my first time volunteering for a campaign, and yeah, it's just been really fun. So right now I'm making phone calls to people.
Yeah. It's been a lot of great people have turned out for the movement. It's been quite an exciting group.
Yeah.
You met some cool people?
Yeah, it's been really fun to interact and see everyone's views and stuff, because there's so many different people that support Bernie for different reasons. You know, there's Republicans that even support him, which I found really surprising. And it's been so fun to see what other people value in a candidate, you know, and how that varies from person to person. You know, for some people it's gay rights, for some people it's how Bernie views trade and, you know, the union and stuff like that. To see like what people care about, it's so wide, and the fact that Bernie represents all of that, I think it's great.
Yeah. Right on. So say your name again and where you're from.
Hannah Bishi. I'm from here in Fort Dodge.
Right on. And you think we're going to win Fort Dodge? Think the caucus is going to go our way?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's going to be really tight, but I think overall Bernie's going to get Iowa. It sounds pretty good.
All right.
Hi, I'm Meg Bishi, and I'm from Fort Dodge, Iowa, and I'm here with my daughter, and we're helping to work for the Bernie campaign to get people to get out and caucus tomorrow night. This is a big deal for Iowa, so we're really excited to help out any way we can.
So you said your friends have been calling you to
all morning long, and it's wonderful that they trust me to give them information, because they wanted to know a little bit more, and we were happy to educate them and tell them, you know, why they should caucus for Bernie. And so they were undecided, and when they got done talking to me, they wanted to know where to caucus. I helped them find the information, and they'll be caucusing for Bernie tomorrow night, which really makes my day, because I just checked the email one more time, and now we're up to 6 that we are going to be getting to caucus for Bernie. That's pretty cool.
It is cool. Right on. And so you lived in Fort Dodge for a long time?
I've been here for about 20 plus years.
All right. It's nice. I like it here. So tell me, you said Bernie was making headway in the Republican area near Fort Dodge. Tell me about that.
Well, it's just chatter I've been seeing, tracking, watching, and it seems like what's been dominantly Republican for so long in counties west of here have seemed to be turning a little shift, and it seems like Bernie's really kind of keying in with these people and what they like and what their beliefs and values are, and that's really neat to see.
Anything else you want to say about Bernie? And,
just go, Bernie. We want you to win. Good luck. And the weather's going to be fine, so no excuses. Get out and caucus.
All right, so what are you doing here, sweetheart?
My husband volunteered me.
But he's not here?
No.
But you're here.
I'm here.
All right.
He's got a bad back, so it's hard for him to get out. But
fair enough.
He likes to volunteer me, so.
Cool. Well,
I have never done anything like this before, so I guess that's a revolution too. It was to me.
Yeah.
And Bernie just moves me. I'll tell you, that guy talks about all the things that are important. Middle class, it's been in decline for 40 years. Productivity has gone up 80%. Middle class wages are just flat. Okay, so he's for the middle class. Healthcare is a right. It is not something that's a privilege for only the people that can afford it. Mm-hmm. So Bernie is definitely my man.
I would say the revolution is about showing the world, you know, we want to be a world leader, and I remember this, it's from The Wire, some show, he's like, you know, we're number one in lots of things. We're number one in incarceration, in childhood obesity, and poverty, you know. It's like, we should be, Bernie Sanders, I think, is going to help bring this country, lead this country in the direction where we can actually be proud to go around the world and say, I'm an American again.
This country is so wealthy,
yeah.
And the wealth distribution is grossly disproportionate, and also the income. All of the new income that's generated because Obama did the right thing and got the economy back on scale again, most of that has gone to the upper 1% people.
That's right.
That is just something grossly wrong with it.
Feel the burn.
We're going to change that.
Bow.
So you may be wondering why there's like a film of a highway sequence there at the end there with you know, the tractor trailer. It says, stop eminent domain abuse. That was a really hard shot to get. I'm like driving in the snow and I had to pull over and I get this thing. But it was outside of Des Moines on the highway towards Fort Dodge was this like tractor trailer parked beside the road that someone had put in, stop eminent domain abuse, an issue that is really all over the country now related to pipelines because of sort of this freewheeling FERC problem, which is that there's an agency and a rogue agency in D.C. that's not playing well with others and basically giving permits to override the EPA laws and the water laws. And there is a full-blown citizen movement to address this issue. People like Beyond Extreme Energy will be in D.C. in May 16th. And you can find more online at Beyond Extreme Energy. We are the Rubber Stamp Rebellion, which is a group that's seeking to challenge the sort of government complicity with these projects. Because, for example, here in Vermont, the Vermont Department of Public Service has been rubber stamping permits for the Vermont gas pipeline through Middlebury. My friend Claire Boughton, who had a problem with that, has a problem with that because she lives next to the Velco corridor where they want to put a pipeline underneath the transmission lines of this electrical line. So my friends and I were there not so long ago, and so check out this video of Rising Tide Vermont, which came together to sing a song outside of Claire Boughton's house.
Officer, my dear, everybody, all the people here are telling you to leave these folks alone. There's no need to take. It's time to leave.
the gas inside the ground. We're singing out for climate justice now.
Nate McBride, tell us what happened today. What do
well,
you think?
We were too menacing for the Vermont Gas and Public Service Board officials. So they didn't even drive by the blockade that we did. So people are pretty pumped. We had a very successful action, and we're going to continue to do this stuff because we cannot let Vermont Gas, a corporation, seize Vermonters' land for just a couple of businesses in Middlebury. It doesn't make any sense at all. So we will be back. The menacing crew will be back.
Okay, friend, I know you're my super articulate friend here, Native American from the original people of Vermont.
I'm Charlie D. Magazo. I'm a Nohegan Kalasak Abenaki. I showed up today basically because this is just wrong on all levels that I can think of in terms of not just the environment. I mean, they have no disregard for themselves as human beings, and here we are, you know, wanting to tear up, destroy another living entity. The earth is alive. It's as alive as me and you. We all have souls. This has a soul, and it's not being respected. They don't even respect each other. We have a retired senior citizen who's disabled, and they want a forced eminent domain on the person. They do this to another human being. They do this to their own kind. When are we going to get beyond this? When are we going to collectively as a society work together and say, you know, yeah, we have energy needs, but, you know, we can work it out in another way that's respectful to a live earth, respectful to another human being. And I think that's the message. It's what we need to start working towards. Thanks.
So give us a little update. Tell us what happened today.
Here. So today, Claire was supposed to have an appraisal done on her property. This appraisal was something that the governor decided us landowners needed in order to help us. And really, it's helping the Public Service Board litigate against us. And it's just, it was a bone that Shumlin threw the landowners when we asked for his help. And this appraisal won't help Claire. It's a step in the process. And so Rising Tide, 350, and a bunch of the Upper Valley people made a human chain, and we blocked it from happening. But actually, we didn't have to block anything because the department decided we were too menacing. So
the WPTZ and WCX both wanted to talk. They said, why don't you come inside where it's warmer? But I still think, why don't you just stay here? And I'm just going to say the same thing I've been saying all afternoon, which is,
because
they have the First Amendment right to do whatever they want, and you invited the department onto your property, and whatever happened, happened.
That it's not a good thing to put in this land.
Really raise this issue in every possible legal channel for the last several years, and have come to a point where I think folks have been really shocked by how unwilling elected leaders, the board, the department, the folks that are supposed to be, you know, kind of looking out for the public, how unwilling they've been to consider the public comment on this one, to take into account that dozens and hundreds of people really over the last several years have spoken out against this thing. And this is kind of like, you know, we're getting to the point where we're going to be seeing a lot more actions like this. We're going to be seeing a lot of people, if they start building this thing in the spring, this is kind of just the beginning. I think you're seeing some foreshadowing of what looks to be like a pretty exciting spring and summer.
Two other land holders who are facing eminent domain, who are going to be facing the same thing. They're going to be back to try and mess with Claire's house. They're going to be here to try and clear the way to bring in machines. So it's ongoing. They're clearing right now along the Velco corridor to put the pipe in the ground. Some of you may have seen it on 116 on the route in. So when I say see you next time, I mean that from the bottom of my heart, that I really enjoyed being here with all of you today, and I really want to do it again. and we need to know this song. Maybe we need to know some other things, but we'll start with the song.
Because nothing really did happen, because what the Public Service Board wanted to do, they didn't do. They were going to come here for an appraisal, and they didn't do it at the last minute because people were here. And the people that were here, I thought the world of anyways, because they're all against the pipeline, and they wouldn't have hurt the appraisers at all. All they just had to do was come here if they wanted to.
That's right.
And they didn't, so heck with it.
Yeah, and you weren't going to sell anyway, so the appraisal, can you say a little bit about that?
It was for eminent domain, is what the appraiser was of the property down here, I believe, wasn't it, Jane?
Yeah.
They
tell you what your property's worth.
Right.
They send it to somebody from New Hampshire to tell you what your property's worth.
I don't think they were looking at the house or anything. I think it was just the land, wasn't it? Where the pipeline was going.
Okay.
I mean, I would have thought that, but I don't know that for sure, but I think so.
Final comment? You don't want to sell and you don't want the pipeline. Tell about your mother getting burned.
When I was young, my mother always was bad off with gas because I watched my mom open up her oven door, and she was really slammed in the head. It was terrible. She was really, and I've always been very afraid of gas. And
so you saw that when you were a young girl?
They've had gas stoves, and I won't even come in with a gas stove. I make sure they change it before I do.
And so you just, because you saw that as a kid, you don't want an explosive pipeline in your backyard.
I'm scared to death of gas. I've seen all these others and read all these other people where they've had all this problem with gas explosions and all, and this is what's very scary. And then they're going up the road here with a distribution line, so you're going to live right in the middle of this. And when you live with it on a roadway, the way they speed through here and stuff, I don't think that's a safe thing. So at my age, I just don't want to do it. That's all there is to it. I just do not want to do it. And the people that were here today don't want it either. So I think we just realize there's a lot of younger people that are against this from rising tide and stuff like that. And they've got the rest of their lives to live in this. And this is a good thing for them not to get involved in this, to start this in. That's how I feel. Mm-hmm.
All right. Thank you, Claire Bowden. Moncton, Vermont.
That's all I...
Raiser of pomegranates, friend of cats, pipeline opponent.
Yep.
And I'm your host. My name is Theo Talcott. This has been The Climate Show, straight from Moncton, Vermont, where we try and make media to oppose pipelines and represent justice. So thank you for watching this on the web or on cable access TV. Thank you to my friends at GNAT TV. You guys are awesome. All right. So as you can see, it's a lively time to be an American. We have such a beautiful democracy, and it seems to be breathing a little bit more than usual, which is exciting. We love it. To life. Let's talk about Ta-Nehisi Coates. Ta-Nehisi Coates, I want you to be my friend. This book is the best book. Everyone should read it, and we should make a new world based on what it says. Ta-Nehisi Coates came up in the Bernie campaign about a month ago because he wrote an article for The Atlantic, which was like, what is Bernie Sanders' position on reparations? Which was, unfortunately, there was like a little bit of not niceness to him, I thought, online, because he's a great writer and he doesn't deserve any venom from the left. But people, if you criticize Bernie, people are sometimes not nice back, you know, so. But his article was fair. He's saying like reparations are maybe necessary for us to like face the problem squarely. Like if we're not going to say how much land and labor we stole from the black folks who built this country, like how are we ever going to like pay them back or address the problem squarely? It's like if you're poor and black, or you're rich and white, shouldn't be blamed for that. Especially if, like, for many centuries, like, you've been stolen from and plundered. This is just, you know, a way to think. I have this book on tape, and I've been, like, bludgeoning myself in the car for, like, 6 months. And it's great. I recommend it. If you want to, like, suffer a little bit, which is good. It's like Jung said, if you don't suffer, you'll have neurosis.
I think he said something like, the origin of all neurosis is like avoidance of legitimate suffering. So it's like the Buddha said, you know, you have to suffer a little bit. Life is suffering. And if you just avoid it, then you might, the next thing you know, you're like a guy who's like, oh, I can't feel any pain. I just do my job, putting the Jews on the train. Next thing you know, you're in the Trump Towers. You know, it just happens that way. But I digress. In the meantime, we have an upcoming event in Albany that you're going to want to know about. If you want to stop the bomb trains, did you know 350.org is organizing an event in Albany? These trains, which travel through Manchester also, you know, the Omeo cars have propane, liquid natural gas, that is like super explosive. God help us if we ever have an accident. This whole sort of like above ground shipment through communities, residential communities, that's dangerous. And if you're driving down Albany to Albany, you can see these trains parked beside 787 before you get on 787 South. The 787 corridor transiting Albany, you'll see the parked black car that when they like shake on the track and like Coca-Cola cans, and then when they sit there, they like loosen the tops, which off gas all these weird chemicals into the communities they travel through. I mean, I guess it's by the road there, 787. If you don't notice, the air is bad there. Well, the houses across the street probably do. So just another data point in the sort of struggle to save the world from oil companies that have no conscience whatsoever. Well, we're going to take a break. I'm going to send you off to the next video. We're going all the way back to New Hampshire now to hear about the political revolution as seen in Keene.
Well, I'm calling to earn your support for Bernie Sanders. Bernie's an honest leader who has spent a lifetime fighting injustice and inequality. In Congress, he stood up for working families and for principle opposing the hierarchy.
Help people get in and get out from canvassing. So I thought she could be canvassing on radio TVs probably.
Cool.
We have people from around the world actually coming to the United States, New Hampshire specifically, to help on this campaign. Because it shows that this really is a world movement. This really is a movement to better the people and not just a political campaign. This encompasses all movements. This isn't just Bernie. This is all these different social movements that are happening in the new millennium right now. And, you know, it's time to get Bernie Sanders elected. It's time to elect other officials that are going to work with him who have similar values that we all share, not just politicians and billionaires share. And it's time to get this country back to a country built off of people like myself and all the people that I, you know, surround myself with from all different age groups and demographics, and not just a handful of billionaire people.
I love the optimism you hear in the voice there, isn't it, of Thomas? Really wonderfully clear. Meanwhile, the Vermont political establishment is doing some good work at getting on board with climate change as a problem to deal with. And we give compliments to the Vermont Council on Rural Development, Paul Costello and his friends, who have organized a pretty cool event that you're going to see some footage of from now, which is called, it was the Vermont Climate Economy Summit. Happened this winter. February 22nd up in the Vermont Technical College, and they're trying to do this kind of smart thing. They're trying to say, like, well, we have to build an economy that, we have climate change, we have to have an economy, where is the medium ground? And they're trying to bring people together to talk about that. I think that's awesome. So you can check that. There's a partnership online. You can see this number I'm going to show you right here. And check out the Vermont Council on Rural Development, and listen to some of our heroes. We have up deck is Senator Leahy, who has not endorsed Bernie Sanders yet, but we expect him to any moment. And so check it out.
Listen to the high-minded
debates by some running for president. You think they're going to talk about climate change? Do you think they're going to talk about global warming? I mean, some of them sound like you have to convince them the globe is round. Talking about warming, actually one of these leaders saw snowballs in the Senate chamber to say, well, see, it's not warming. Ha. I'm starting to care a little bit. But, you know, we can make a change here. People respect Vermont values. They respect the fact that we're leaders on so many things. Because if we don't, the next generation is going to ask everyone, where were you when our generation was coming up? Where were you? I think we can answer it pretty well. You know, productive brainstorming, someone says, should be like sitting on a pin. Should make you jump up and do something. Well, as we say Shakespearean English, by Jesus Christ, we're Vermonters. We know how to do this.
So if you think about the legacy of fossil fuels, aside from the change to the weather, it's been one of concentration of wealth and power because of the very nature of the fossil fuels, where they sit, under whose feet. So we're going to make it more decentralized, meaning more locally owned than the concentration that was necessary for the capitalization of the central station power plants and the grid that we've built historically. And potentially, we might even make a more decentrally owned grid and power system more democratically controlled. And you know, coming from the state of Bernie, I hope you all feel that and think that that's a good prospect. It takes work, it's a struggle, there's friction, we're up against enormous vested interests, we're still an insurgent group up against an incumbent technology set who have incredibly powerful vested interests behind them and a huge amount of wealth and power that they've accumulated through a century of that central station electricity and energy system, but we have everything else on our side. So that's what we've got to get right. And that's what we're going to do, because we have to, for the kids that Rick's been taken care of. And this Vermont economy, the climate economy document that I read from last year's thing, I was really gratified, the last thing I'll say, to see how much focus you put on two areas that I don't think gets enough talk when we do this. It's sort of a technological discussion, mostly, around the world. You know, how do you switch out solar for coal or gas or whatever, and that's critical too, and we do a lot of that at CalCEF and CalCharge, the battery consortium that I also am privileged to lead. But it's as much a finance problem as it is a technological one, so the fact that you have a whole working group here today on clean energy finance collaboratives and different models of thinking about ownership and investment through that change and the energy transition is critical. Rewiring America and then wiring the world with clean energy is an exciting opportunity to create value, create careers, do all that sort of thing. And I spend a lot of time trying to work out how to support entrepreneurs to succeed and how to attract them into this space. And Vermont, as a lab for the nation, could become incredibly important in doing that. You know, the work that you've already done, you know, stands very tall in the country. As Mary mentioned, you're already number two or three in the per capita stakes on the jobs index. We do a head count every year of how many people do that work. So this is a census. The methodology is not like one of these induced labor projections that the oil and gas guys did for Dakota, where they were sort of counting the strippers and prostitutes as well as the rig operators and all the rest of it. This is actually who's working in the solar industry. And every year, out of the Great Recession, since 2008, it's grown by 10 to 20,000 people. 10 to 20% and more.
Yeah.
Over the last,
where'd you get it?
My friend made it for me. He's also a puppet.
Amazing. Mm-hmm. He has great skill.
Yeah, he's a chief puppet.
It looks like the work of that amazing guy from Bennington, who is hosting All Species Day on April 23rd in Bennington, from 1 to 6 in downtown Bennington.
It's awesome. It's gonna be lots of different bands,
reggae bands, Irish bands, right in downtown Bennington. Interfaith
all
prayer,
species and
all species day, because we're for all species.
Yep.
And his name is
Fidel. He is the chief.
My friend. knows how to pray over water. We love this guy.
Awesome. Are you going to go, Ivana? Are you going
to
be there?
I would like to be there, yeah.
Are you guys going to go out there and TV land?
Hope so.
We'll see you down at All Species Day events on April 23rd. Here's the link. Cool.